Why don't you give us an introduction into your previous experience in the fashion and styling industry and where your business is today?
Okay, so my name is Tracy Jeske. I'm an international personal stylist and the founder of En Vogue Stylist. I started my career in fashion when I was 17, so 30 some years ago, and it started in retail. I was actually going to university at the time, and it was a very dark period of my life. I hated university. It was something that just, I was talented. It was my gift because I was very musical, but it wasn't my passion. And there's a very big difference between what you're talented and gifted in and what is your passion. And my passion was fashion. And so I got my very first job in retail, and the very first Gap that came to Canada was the coolest thing ever, because we saw all these Americans, you know, in Gap and 17 magazine, and we're like, oh my God. So I got my first job there, and it literally lit me up. Like, I knew the first day I could be on the floor literally 12 hours. It probably wasn't legal, but I could just like, I absolutely loved it. And so from there, I quit university. And I had very supportive parents, so I was very lucky in that. And I just went for it. And you become assistant manager, and from there, I managed the Gap kids and Gap, and I had about 40 some people working under me, and I loved it. Then at the age of 22, I wanted to hit reset on my life. I moved to Australia, and I knew no one. I packed everything in these two huge suitcases. It was hilarious.
What made you choose Australia?
Well, when you're from Canada and minus 50 weather, you dream about Australia. Like, there's just nothing. I mean, I loved Hawaii, but it's impossible to move to the States. So Australia was just my dream. And I ended up moving to Surfers Paradise, which for a Canadian and the Rocky Mountains, Surfers Paradise was just like a dream come true. And there I found myself working in the fashion industry there, working in retail. And after 4 years of living there and coming back and forth to Canada, I met this man in Canada while renewing my visa, who would become my future husband. And he swept me off my feet. So I never went back to Australia, but I moved to Italy. And so I've been here for 20 some years, and I started personal styling business, because moving here, I knew nobody and I couldn't speak the language. And this was a real block for me. And this is what kind of made me sink or swim moment, because when you can't speak a language, you don't realize it. And I'm not a person who likes to be invisible. And in that moment, I became invisible because I couldn't speak to anybody. Nobody saw me. I was like, I was transparent. So I had to use what I knew best in that moment to become seen, to become heard. And you know, Rachel Zoe's quote, your style is a way of saying who you are without speaking a word. That is so true. I used my style. I upped it even more than what I was before. And people started to notice me. And it was that moment where a light bulb went off and I had my aha moment. And I thought, this is so empowering. Style is not frivolous. No. It is so profound, and it goes so much deeper than that. Because when you work in retail, I know when I left university, oh my God, you're working in retail. Like, what are you doing? Like, you know, like people don't think it's like, it's something that goes so much deeper than just what you're wearing on the outside and a label. So that is when I decided that I wanted to help women, because it was really a difficult period. And I had an eating disorder. And that was also another thing that was going on in my life. And my style is also something that saved me from some of the darkest moments in my life, because as long as I always made sure I dressed up, I always made sure I looked good. Because if I started looking the part of being sick, I wouldn't be here today. So my style literally saved my life. Like, in that moment, it wasn't because I wanted to hide or make people think I wasn't ill. It was for me. I wanted to make sure that I saw myself looking good. So it convinced myself that I was feeling good. And eventually I did drop, you know, I got over my eating disorder. It's been 20 some years, but style has been always by my side in every phase of my life. So this is where I came in my 40s after my second child, that I wanted to open my own business and stop making it a jobby. So I opened up my own styling business. I took every course there was imaginable. I went to New York. I've had mentors in the styling business, Kelly Lundberg, which you know as well. And so this is where I started to create my business. And going into my 40s, I saw women who were my age going through what I went through in my 20s and 30s. They were feeling invisible. They were very insecure. Their bodies were changing. They were loathing everything about themselves, about aging. So I wanted to help them to embrace the season of their life and walk into it with ease and grace.
Yes. What a fabulous story and very succinct. It's interesting. I completely agree with the concept of dressing for the feeling that you want, or, you know, the old adage of dress for the day, dress for the job you want, not the job you have. I personally, as you know, I'm not a stylist, but embarrassingly, I remember when I finished school, I used to dress up in a suit and go and sit in a cafe, a busy cafe in the CBD. Cause I, in my mind, I'm like, if I dress like a businesswoman, I shall become a businesswoman, you know, and that's that is ludicrous, but also it's true. This argument that I think a lot of image professionals come up against, or a barrier for clients to book in with them, is, well, you know, booking a stylist, it's something frivolous. It's not a have to have, it's a nice to have. And they don't realize that this could almost be categorized under health and wellness. Working with a stylist so you can understand the colors and shapes that make you pop and make you feel fabulous is a method of self-care.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It really is. It can take you from some of your darkest moments to help you get through it and empower you into some of your brightest. Because yes. You cannot have a bright moment in your life if you're dressing frumpy and grumpy. Like if you wake up frumpy and grumpy, it's all about your morning routines and everything that goes with it. But if you wake up frumpy and grumpy and you don't snap out of that, you are going to choose something that makes you look frumpy and grumpy. And that is my big thing. Like your morning routine, work it out, get yourself in such a high energy level that when you open your wardrobe, you're going to choose something that pops and is vibrant and makes you just want to go out and knock down those doors that are in front of you.
So if we know that so many women, so many individuals rather, are waking up feeling frumpy and grumpy, which is a great phrase, what is it that makes them choose frumpy and grumpy instead of choosing to work with a stylist? Do you find that people are still uncertain as to how this whole process works?
Yeah, I think that a lot of people, there's still that mentality that a stylist is for women who have a lot of money, it's celebrity, it's the status quo, which it is. There are women who do work with celebrities and red carpet, but there are also women like me who work with, you know, every type of individual. There's every kind of price budget. And I think women think that if they have a stylist, we're going to take them shopping and make them buy everything new, which
yes.
is this, you know, myth that, oh my God, I'm going to have to invest in her. Plus I have to buy everything new. It's not like that. You know, we have to educate that actually we take what you have and make the most of it. And actually we help you eliminate, but you don't want more. I don't want my clients to go out and buy more. I want them to be able to use what they have. They just have too much most of the time. Like all of us women, we love to buy. Mm-hmm. And so you don't need 100 pair of heels if you're a sporty girl. Like who does that, you know? Or vice versa, if you're an elegant woman and you love to dress up in heels, why would you have 200 pair of sneakers in your wardrobe? So it's just clarity and clearance on what your client needs and help them through the process and get that trust built up inside, like, because they're very insecure and vulnerable also. That's another issue.
Yes. And to that point, on sort of building trust and credibility, I know that was one of your initial marketing objectives. You mentioned that when you started your business, having a website and Instagram, you know, is not enough. It's the next step is for you in your brand journey was to establish yourself as an expert. So do you find that in the work that you've done, the PR activity that you've pursued to position yourself as an expert, has that made the difference in terms of people choosing to work with you over another stylist?
Yeah, I think so. And especially women, my niche is very much women 40 and beyond. Mm-hmm. So women 40 and beyond, I think are very selective and I think every woman at every age is very selective and vulnerable. But in my case, I found that, you know, why would I want to work with you? And I find that also women are very much behind the scenes. So I may not be seeing them active. Those are not the women who are commenting. My clients really never commented. It's saying beautiful, love your look.
They on your social media.
Yeah, they were very much behind the scenes and all of a sudden they would pop out from nowhere and I didn't even know. They're like, I've been following you for a couple of years. I absolutely love your style. Do you work with women in the States? Because I'm in Italy. I'm like, yes, of course I do. I didn't even know you were there, you know? So we don't really realize who's watching us, that the eyes that are on us. So, you know, even if you're not getting your clients trust me, they are there and they're watching you and they're comparing you to others. So we always have to make sure that our message is clear, what we're saying, and we're not flipping around that one day I'm working with someone in their 40s. So then I go back to, you know, everyone be very consistent on what your message is, because that will sit in, that builds trust as well.
Such a good point. I've spoken at length about this topic, the buyer cycle, the buyer journey, and how important it is to use this as the framework for any marketing content that you create, whether it's emails, social media posts, ads, PR. And every image professional that I interview has exactly the same experience. A lot of the time, the clients that they have that are booking in are ones that are typically not particularly vocal when it comes to engagement on social media posts, but they have continued along the journey of seeing everything you're doing, reading all your blog posts, keeping an eye out, your front of mind for them when they eventually need, when they're ready to purchase, when they have that intent. And then lo and behold, all of a sudden you get a call, which looks to you to be out of the blue, but they've been following you, as you said, for a long time.
Absolutely. You know, and so that's why I think it's, you know, our social is really important. Our website is so important. But, you know, there's also that going over and becoming an expert, because for me, it wasn't enough. So that's why I started going into media and trying to get myself out there on, you know, on different types of, you know, whether it being interviewed by journalists, being on TV, being seen. So, you know, to build that credibility, we need to get out there in every area. That's at least that's what worked for me. Once I started getting out and being seen on TV, which has just been happening recently, but, you know, it took me a few years to get into that and be able to build the credibility to be able to get on certain programs. But this is what also helps you get your message out and to have women know that, you know, and I think it's very intimidating when you see somebody dressed perfectly all the time who thinks that, you know, it's like, you know, I can't cook, you know, I'm not good at cooking in Italy, which is like the worst thing, like for it's a woman, like, it's just like, you can't do that. But you know, we're not perfect in everything. I can't cook and I'm fine. So if I wanted to take a cooking course, I probably could learn it. And that's the same message that I want my women to realize that are following me, that, you know, you don't have to be like me. You don't have to have the pink hair. I'm going to give you the tools that I know that will make it, you know, that will help you every day, make your life easier, accept your body, love your look, feel fabulous, but not on the outside, but only on the outside, but on the inside as well. So there's so much that goes around with what we're trying to send the message to our future clients.
So for stylists that are listening that think, okay, great. Yes, I understand now I need to build my credibility. I need to position myself as a subject matter expert, but I'm just starting. How do I go about securing interview spots or editorial coverage or TV interviews? Did you feel that you needed to create a killer pitch to send out to people? Or what was your approach when you were first trying to book gigs?
Well, that, yeah, you do. Yeah, a killer. You need to have the right pitch. So whether that be of somebody who helps you. And, you know, I think also having a mentor, you know, I've always had a mentor during my career when I started out being a personal stylist, because you want that person that you look up to that is doing exactly what you're doing. And that person will help you get to where you want to go faster, because that mentor has been through it, made mistakes that, you know, and she will save you that part, he or she. So, you know, that is the most important part, even before getting PR, is having someone who knows what they're doing and has been there before. And she will help you and guide you through. So if you know, for me, it was, my dream was to be on TV and to be in magazines. So that's where we focused on, and she helped me with that. I, by myself, probably wouldn't have been able to do that, you know, eventually maybe, but it's always, it's asking for help. I think it's so important when you're first starting. And even for me now that I've been in the industry 30 years, but I've had my styling business for the past 7 or 8 years, you know, it's so important to have somebody by your side, so you're not alone. And it also makes you accountable for what you're doing, because if you don't, you know, you have a call every 2 weeks or whatever it is, and you were told, okay, go do this, this, this. If nobody's there to check to see if you did it, you probably, if you're like me, I probably wouldn't do it. But having a mentor by your, or a coach by your side, I think is so fundamental.
It is ironic. I haven't told you to say that, but it's a really great message for me and my podcast, obviously, being a marketing agency. But I think the other point is that when you're trying to be creative in building your business, you're trying to be strategic in terms of the modeling, you're trying to apply time and space and energy to the styling component, the actual, you know, the client time, it is a lot for one person. And when you have your own business, you're typically not working in an office with others. So sometimes you sort of, you need that dynamic engagement with another person to generate ideas, bounce ideas off. And again, asking someone that's perhaps a few years ahead of you to say, in hindsight, would you have gone about that differently? It's really, I completely agree. Having a person or a team of people, a selection of people can make all the difference. How did you find your mentor?
On Instagram.
Really?
On Instagram, doing exactly what I wanted to do. And I absolutely loved her style. I loved her personality. And she was doing everything. She was everything I wanted, living in Dubai, you know, helping. It just was, she created this, you know, this aura around her, which made me say, I want to be like her.
Mm. How beautiful. And so now that you've been able to secure these, the editorial coverage and the interviews on podcasts and TV, what do you do with those to share them with your audience and I guess use them as consideration content to move people closer to a booking?
Yeah, it's very, you have to be very careful because there's a fine line between bragging and saying, this is me, who I am, look at me, and using it as education. So I never say, oh, wow, look at me, I'm on TV. No, I say, okay, you know, from somebody who was very insecure, who was hidden for many years because of her eating disorder, now to make it out and get my message out and be able to have other women understand the power of style. Like you use it in a way that is helping people. It's not to boost your ego and make you feel like, you know, you've won the Oscar, because that's not it. I'm not on there because I, you know, for my ego, I'm on there because I want to reach as many women as possible. And, you know, you can only do so many Zoom calls, and on Instagram, the algorithm is what it is. We all know that. So you can have 50,000 followers or 100,000, but if your posts aren't getting out there, the women aren't seeing it. And that's what I want. I want to be able to serve and bless as many people as I can. That's my thing, not for me, it's for others. And that's where I always want to come from. And I want people to know that it's not about me. It's about that one woman who's at home and maybe she's just got divorced. Maybe she's in her 50s. She's feeling, she's going through menopause. Everything feels like it's going against her. And she sees me and she says, if she can do it, I can do it too. And that's what I want. And that's what I want for all stylists as well. Mm. You know, I'm not that I'm somebody famous or whatever. I'm not, but if I can do it, you can do it. I know nothing about that. I'm like, you know, I know, you know, I'm just like the most, you know, not, I don't want to say handicapped because that's not a native word, but I'm not techie at all. And so for me to be able to do online and things like that, if I can do it, literally anybody can.
How have you found your clients and the response to virtual styling? So for some, if it's not a strength of yours, what's the process been like for you, and have your clients enjoyed it, or would they much prefer to work with you in person?
I've absolutely loved it. I was so afraid of it. But, you know, what you fear most is, like, I think that's what your calling is, because, you know, when something's too comfortable, you're not pushing yourself beyond your, you know, so getting out of my comfort zone and actually going online was a fabulous thing, a tool for me, because it built my confidence. And I absolutely love working with my clients because I can work with as many as I want, and I don't have jet lag, and I don't, you know, I'm not having to abandon my family. So there's a lot less fighting going on in the house because I'm not flying here and there. I'm present. So, you know, and I've gotten the tools, you know, and I think, you know, it's a really beautiful opportunity. I really think virtual is something that I will keep doing even once the doors open, for sure.
Yeah. It's definitely for stylists that would like to reach an international or an interstate client, it's brilliant, but it's also great just to implement as a recurring kind of maintenance service, you know, where if you've done a big wardrobe cleanse or a big shop or color and body analysis, but then you just want to top up that knowledge and inspiration with your clients, that's virtual is a really easy way of doing that. I wanted to talk about something that I thought was really interesting the way that you've almost incorporated the wardrobe cleanse as the part in every service that every client receives. So can you talk me through that concept and why you've chosen to implement it as part of every service rather than have it as a separate one?
Well, I just think it's all part of the package. It's so important for us to go inside our client's wardrobe because that's where the message is. Like when you open up your client's wardrobe and there is chaos and confusion, you absolutely know what's going on inside of her. Like that is where the story is for me. Once I see her wardrobe, then I can understand what we're going through because there's shame, there's guilt of too much shopping, there's tags on there, there's disorder. And it's, you know, it's also for her. If I want her to feel good on the inside, then I got to get rid of all that's going around her because it's adding absolute weight on her shoulders and it's stressing her out. So until we get into her wardrobe and we get rid of what isn't serving her, all those, you know, those things that she's holding on to that have, you know, negative energy, there's energy vampires in our wardrobes, in all of our wardrobes. And we have to be very careful of that because everything is energy. And so that's probably, I'm very much on energy, as you can see in vibration. So if she's got a low vibe going on in her wardrobe, that's what she's carrying through in all of her looks and everything that she's going through in the day. So it's so important to cleanse. You know, if you're going on a diet, if you're doing, you know, if you're wanting to get healthier, the first thing you have to do is cleanse your body. And that's exactly what I do in the wardrobe. Let's get that cleanse out. And so we can start breathing again.
It's so interesting because I think that a wardrobe cleanse is probably one of the most attractive services for image professionals because nearly everyone would say, oh, I would love someone to come and have a look at the clothing I already have. Tell me if it suits me or not. Show me some different ways of wearing things. So in actual fact, it's almost like the foundational service, although I guess you might prefer to do a color or body shape analysis first, but the wardrobe cleanse, starting with what you have, potentially helps these clients understand that the focus of styling is not to buy more, it's to maximize what you have.
Yeah, I don't want them to go out and buy more because I know they've got it in there. We just have to find it. So once we get rid of everything, you know, I may do the wardrobe detox first because I want her to start feeling better about her wardrobe. So then what's left, then I can kind of figure out her personality because what she's keeping is telling me what she prefers more. So there's already a key at what her personality is. So if she's going for, you know, for lace or for tulle or whatever it is, I can see that she's a romantic, whatever that is, you know, if she's like the long, or if she's more into like, you know, glamour dresses or fitted clothing, I get an idea of what her personality is just by seeing by what she's keeping. Also the colors, because your color is obviously your hair and your skin, but what you're attracted to, you know, so what she's attracted to, I can even get her personality even in there and what colors I can use in her when I'm doing her color palette, because I don't want to eliminate those colors if it's something that, you know, she really loves. I want her to love it. And if it makes her feel good, then she should wear it. These are all guidelines that we give our clients, but they're not rule, you know, it's not life or death, because I can tell my woman that she's, you know, an hourglass shape, but if she tells me she wants to wear something that's, you know, flattering for a rectangle, I'm going to tell her to go for it. I'm not going to tell her that she can't wear it. You know, we have to give her the guideline, but after it's up to her, whatever makes her feel wonderful and feel good, she does what she wants in the end, but it's just guidelines. But yeah, I'm very much into the wardrobe.
And so do you think that that's what the majority of your clients come to you for first, or do they end up saying to you, Tracy, just sort me out completely. I've got no idea what I'm doing.
Well, I think when you get to the certain age, it's like there's a revolution inside of a woman. Like she's evolving, she's changing. You're not the same as your body is not the same as it is. Your hormones are different. So everything is just changing in that woman. And I see that she wants something just completely fresh, using what she has, but spicing it up, changing it. And, you know, a lot of times she will get rid of 90% of what's in her wardrobe because a lot of women, when they get in their 40s or even in their 50s, more so, they're hanging on to clothing that they had when they were 30, you know, and before kids. And they keep telling themselves, when I fit into these pair of jeans, then, you know, I'm going to be the happiest woman in the world. Well, you know what? Get rid of those jeans because you're never going to fit into them again. Life happens. Kids happen. Your body, you know, I'm tiny, but I'm not as tiny as I was before I had kids. Yeah. So if I keep those skinny jeans, I'm torturing myself every day because I'm giving my value, my worth to a number.
And rather you just have a wardrobe full of clothing you can wear now and feel great now in, rather than a kind of a future closet that you don't touch.
Yeah, you know, and getting them excited about wanting to get in their wardrobe. So yeah, definitely. I see women as they evolve and they age. There's just a lot of confusion, a lot of years of shopping and, you know, yeah, there's just a lot of chaos going on. So it's time to get rid of all that and start fresh.
Mm. So do you find that the clients that you attract from Italy have a potentially more open to working with a stylist? Have you seen any difference in the attitude towards women in that age group, but across the markets?
Well, I literally work with very few women in Italy. It's a very tough market. I work more with the States, with Australia, New Guinea, Canada. I find that in Italy, there's very much, it's very new here. Mm-hmm. And women have this mentality here of, you're telling me I don't know how to dress. You think I don't know how to dress? And women in Italy do dress very well. So you have to like walk on eggshells when you're around them. Yeah. So it can be very offensive because they think that they know everything. And it is, they do dress very well here. Like you do not go out in sweatpants. That's just something you don't do. Like, you know, when I first came here 20 some years ago and I wanted to go to the supermarket to buy some milk, I had on sweats, but they were like Victoria's Secret. I'm not talking, you know, like whatever. Yeah. And my husband said to me, where are you going? And I said, I'm going to get milk. And he's like, not dressed like that. You just don't. So That's just the mentality here. So it's a difficult market to get into, which I have worked with clients here, but I find that the Anglo-Saxon mentality is much more open than what it is here. But I love my clients here. They're fabulous. Once you get in and you make them realize that you're not insulting them and you're not there to steal their money, you know, like you are a valid person, then they love you, but it's just trying to get in there.
And do you feel that the fact that you are based in Italy and you've got 20 years of experience within the Italian culture of art and food and fashion, do you think that's part of the attraction to your brand as well for people that live overseas because you have a finger on the pulse of that European classic style?
Yeah, and that's why I've also decided to start doing retreats because, you know, it's not like as stylists, we have to get creative and we have to start keep thinking of what we can do. So I'm having a retreat on the Amalfi Coast in September, and I'm wanting women from overseas to come and enjoy these four fabulous days on the Amalfi Coast of luxury shopping. I'm going to guide them. I'm going to help them. You know, so it's also that gets my clients for sure. I know that does help me being in the fashion capital of the world. There's that, you know, Americans love Italy and they love what, you know, what kind of that Italian lifestyle. So it does help me. And it also has given me confidence and I am in the fashion capital. So I do see a lot of it around me. So I absolutely love it. I mean, I love where I am.
How fabulous. Tracy, thank you so much for sharing these insights and for taking us inside your business. I really appreciate it because a couple of things. For everyone that's running their own business in the image industry, it can feel like you're on your own. And sometimes you do feel like there are challenges that perhaps you're struggling with more than others, you know, whether it's tech, whether it's marketing, whether it's establishing yourself as an expert in building your brand. So it's really nice to hear from people acknowledging that, yep, it is a challenge. No one's perfect at everything, but obviously leading with your heart, you know, genuinely wanting to help people and support them, but then finding a mentor or a coach, someone to help inspire and guide your decisions and staying the course, you know, not being put off by a lack of followers or likes and comments because people are watching you.
That's right. You know, and you know, it's not overnight. Success is not overnight. And I just want, like, there are times when I literally had no money in my bank and my husband was like, are you nuts following this? But it was my dream and my passion, and it takes time. So just be consistent, have faith. If it's your passion, one day that one door is going to open and you'll never look back.